Well, good morning once again, West Portal. I remember the hiring process that brought James onto our staff team. And our search team was doing due diligence, and they were phoning character references. And one of them described James, this is off script, by the way, this morning, but I can't help myself, described him as the world's happiest man. And as a search team, you just kind of roll your eyes and go, yeah, well, you know, whatever. But they were actually onto something, I think. And the happiness level around West Portal is just a little, well, it's actually a lot enhanced by my friend there as well. It's awesome to be together with you this morning. Back in 1986, I don't know if you remember this, but Christian author Frank Peretti penned at that time what was to become a bit of a groundbreaking novel in Christian fiction. And it was a book by the title of This Present Darkness. How many of you remember the book? Yeah, quite a few of you. And Frank Peretti endeavored in a fictional story to essentially to kind of pull back the curtain and give us a picture of what it might look like if we could see the spirit world around us in the fabric of our everyday lives. And the book was, I want to say it sold over 2.5 million copies. I think it stayed as part of the Christian Booksellers Association's top, like it was on their bestseller list for 150 consecutive weeks. Regardless of what you think of this book's theology or your preference for this kind of a genre of literature, the book did a lot to just raise the awareness of the spiritual struggle that we understand scripturally is going on around us all the time. The book's title is drawn from Paul's letter to the church in Ephesus. In chapter 6, the RSV renders it as follows. He says, "For we are not contending against flesh and blood, but against the principalities, against the powers, against the world rulers of this present darkness." And it fascinates me because I tend to read Ephesians chapter 6 as just kind of a one-off spiritual advice, but he's writing to a very specific context in a very specific city, and that's where we come to today. If we're walking through the book of Acts, looking at kind of the story of how the Jesus movement got off the ground, if you have your Bibles, Acts 19 is where we are going. Paul is in the city of Ephesus, the place he will later write this letter too. While you're turning to Acts 19, I'll maybe just give you a snippet of background on the city itself, just kind of setting the table for us. Ephesus was arguably the first and greatest city of Asia, the province of Asia at this time. Its population probably rivaled some of the largest cities in the Roman Empire, probably around 200,000, thereabouts. For our purposes this morning, James mentioned last week it was a religious center. I'll explain that more later. For now, we can just file that away. It's a very spiritual city. It was known for two things in particular. One was it was the site of one of the largest amphitheaters in the ancient world. I don't know if we have, I hope we have a picture for this here. It's kind of a helicopter shot of the ruins of it today. And it would have been more spectacular back in the first century. But it would seat upwards of 25,000 people. So not a small structure by any standpoint. If you've ever taken in a Saskatoon Rush, one of our local lacrosse games, you know the kind of energy and volume that a crowd of 15,000 people is capable of generating. Almost double the capacity here. The other thing the city of Ephesus was known for was the temple to the Greek goddess Artemis. This was built back in 550 BC, would have had a footprint of a roughly 94,000 square feet, was supported by 127 pillars, all 60 feet high. There is a reason why the Temple of Artemis is considered one of the seven wonders of the ancient world. And for our purposes this morning, I'll simply say, file this away, but a lot of this city's economy is driven by the worship that happens at the temple. And both the amphitheater and the temple feature prominently in our story. They're kind of significant points of reference for us. So if you file that away, Acts 19 is where we are. And we dropped off at verse 7 last week, so I'm just going to jump in at verse 8. And like I love to do, we're going to read some sections and we'll pause and just kind of unpack a few things from them. So Acts 19, starting at verse 8. Paul entered the synagogue and spoke boldly there for 3 months, arguing persuasively about the kingdom of God. But some of them became obstinate. They refused to believe and publicly maligned the way. So Paul left them. He took the disciples with him and had discussions daily in the lecture hall of Tyrannus. This went on for 2 years, so that all the Jews and Greeks who lived in the province of Asia heard the word of the Lord. I'm not sure if you recall, but at the tail end of Paul's second missionary trip, he stops briefly in this city, in Ephesus, and he does a bit of teaching in the synagogue. His message is intriguing enough that at that time, the Jews there say, please stay with us. We'd like to hear more. And Paul says, I don't have time for this now. But he returns, and now he obliges that request as he parks here specifically for some 3 months, unpacking presumably how Jesus has fulfilled the promises that God had for the nation of Israel. It would be a very Jewish-centered message, if you will. Of course, a greater time spent here does not always lead to greater receptivity, and after 3 months, there's enough opposition that Paul is forced to change venues, if you will. And so he moves to the lecture hall of Tyrannus. Now, we're left to fill in a few of the blanks here. Might have been the owner of the hall that rented it to Paul. Probably it was actually the teacher who lectured there himself, which would kind of beg the question, then how can he loan it out to Paul if he's teaching there? And I found this interesting, but apparently in the first century and in and around this kind of area, it was common for a lot of public activity to shut down between the hours of 11 in the morning and 4 in the afternoon. So think of it as a first century elongated version of what we would maybe call a Mexican siesta today. Or if you have Mennonite brother in blood, maybe Metashlope, you would say, is a comparable. Although usually we only do that on Sundays. But a lot of the culture would shut down throughout the heat of the day. And it appears, in fact, we have this in some of our Greek texts. Some of the Greek texts of Acts reference these hours specifically. So the kind of fill in the blanks pieces that we do here is that Paul works a day job in the morning. You recall this. He's a tent maker. This is what he does for a living. Between 11 and 4, when a lot of the economy just kind of takes a break and people go down for a nap, Paul goes, no, this is prime time. This lecture hall is now available. I can step in here. And he uses that time to have public discussions about Jesus with those who will listen. And it's interesting, over the course of the following 2 years, our author kind of summarizes that it's effective enough that he can talk about all of the Jews and Greeks who lived in the province of Asia hearing the word of the Lord. Like that, it's that sense of pervasiveness that the gospel has radiated out, if you will, from the city center of Ephesus. Now, there'd be a handful of reasons for this, certainly. People are coming through the city for trade and commerce, so some will have come, they will have stopped, they will have heard Paul, and then they will take that message back to their other local towns and cities. What we should also just file away here is that some of Paul's colleagues will journey out from Ephesus into little church planting ventures. I'll give you one example of this. We don't know a lot about him, it's just a few cryptic references in our New Testament, but a man by the name of Epaphras comes to faith likely during Paul's ministry here in Ephesus. And Epaphras becomes a church planter in and around the province of Asia. In fact, some of the churches that we understand he planted, one is the church in Colossae. So Paul will later write a letter to this church. Paul doesn't plant the church. This is one of his colleagues. And Epaphras, we believe, also planted churches in Hierapolis and I want to say Laodicea. So Laodicea, if you remember, one of the seven churches in and around the province of Asia that we find referenced in the early chapters of Revelation, presumably all of these churches will have been planted in and around this time period. So it's a very exciting time for the gospel in the province of Asia. I'll maybe stop there. Let's keep our story going. I've asked some of our friends to do that, so check this out.
11-22. God did extraordinary miracles through Paul, so that even handkerchiefs and aprons that had touched him were taken to the sick, and their illnesses were cured, and the evil spirits left them. Some Jews who went around driving out evil spirits tried to invoke the name of Lord Jesus over those who were demon-possessed. They would say, "In the name of Jesus, whom Paul preaches, I command you to come out." Seven sons of Sceva, a Jewish chief priest, were doing this. One day the evil spirit answered them, "Jesus I know, and Paul I know about, but who are you?" Then the man who had the evil spirit jumped on them and empowered them all. He gave them such a beating that they ran out of the house naked and bleeding. When this became known to the Jews and Greeks living in Ephesus, they were all seized with fear, and the name of the Lord Jesus was held in high honor. Many of those who believed now came and openly confessed what they had done. A number who had practiced sorcery brought their scrolls together and burned them publicly. When they calculated the value of the scrolls, the total came to 50,000 drachmas. In this way, the word of the Lord spread widely and grew in power. After all this happened, Paul decided to go to Jerusalem, passing through Macedonia and Achaia. After I have been there, he said, I must visit Rome also. He sent two of his helpers, Timothy and Erastus, and to Macedonia, while he stayed in the province of Asia a little longer.
Thank you, Jenna. So something unusual is happening in Ephesus, and that is that a ministry of what we might call persuasive discussion is complemented by a ministry of extraordinary miracles. Now, I mentioned earlier, and James did last week as well, that Ephesus is a religious center. What we haven't unpacked very specifically is yet, at this point here, I'll do. Ephesus was noted for being a center for what we might call the dark arts, or magic, or the occult. It is noted for this. Paul was in Corinth. We were talking about this a few weeks ago. And ancient Las Vegas, we said. And Corinth had kind of its own reputation such that if you talked about Corinthianizing on the weekend, people just kind of knew what you were talking about. And I'll maybe just leave that there. Ephesus had a bit of a slang expression as well. Such was its reputation in this kind of dark spiritual power and influence that if you talked about Ephesian writings in the ancient world, that's a nice collection of Ephesian writings. Nobody was wondering whether you were talking about poetry or historical fiction. We are talking about occult writings, magic, spells, incantations, and such. So this is the context, what permeates the society here in this city. And again, file that away when you find yourself reading the letter that Paul later writes. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood. Now, miracles are sometimes the way that God chooses to, I'll call it, endorse or validate the truthfulness of the message that is being shared. We find this to be the case at the outset of the book of Acts, where the Holy Spirit comes, the apostles are sharing the good news, people are coming to faith, and the message, the truthfulness of the message is verified by the added ability that God gives some of the apostles to perform miracles. And if you go back to some of your early chapters in Acts, you see there's some very memorable ones, the healing of a cripple that's mentioned specifically. I'm going to reference something that you won't remember, I expect, from Acts chapter 5. If you want, you can kind of thumb back in your Bibles and double check. But there's this weird passage that says, so that those who are sick are trying to get themselves into a place where Peter's shadow might just happen to fall on them. They're hoping that this might happen. Why? Implicitly, this was a source or potential source of healing. Peter's shadow. Now, that's weird, don't get me wrong, but it's not that we're reading something less weird here. Handkerchiefs and aprons are healing people and casting out evil spirits. This is a little odd. These are almost certainly, by the way, clothing articles related to Paul's day job. So think sweat rag around the head, and apron to, you know, wipe his hands off from. And we're not given the kind of details we might really love to ask here, right? Is Paul taking these items around and, like, touching people with them? Like, I don't know what gave him that idea. Are people just kind of helping themselves? You know, Paul left that stuff. He's a pretty powerful guy. Let's see if this does something. And God blesses them. In fairness, by the way, in a culture that's steeped in the whole idea of, like, you know, lucky charms, amulets to ward off evil spirits and such, this is less strange in that kind of a context, like for people to connect dots this way, than it would be for you and for me. And either way, God is blessing this ministry in a significant way. Our author does say these are extraordinary miracles. That's a unique word. It's a descriptive word. It implies that this is not normal even for Paul, but something specific that God gifts him with the ability to do here in Ephesus. I find myself wondering, in a culture that is steeped in an awareness of dark spiritual powers, whether God intentionally wants to make a point that he is sovereign above them. And in this way, it would have some similarities with the story of the Exodus. I won't bother to try to retell it, but we understand that the plagues are not just tremendous acts of, let's call it, punishment or judgment from God, but God is making a statement in these that he is more powerful than the Egyptian deities that many of these would have represented. And I wonder if in this kind of a context, God is choosing to make this kind of a point because it won't be lost on this audience. Which brings us to an exorcism gone horribly wrong. Oh my word. The gospel's initial success seems to lend itself towards those that would like to get in on the act. Call them gospel imitators. Exorcism was not uncommon. And just speaking generally, Jewish priests were kind of thought to have an inside track towards effective exorcism. And the thought process was that if you knew the name of the deity or the most powerful God, it gave you kind of control over them. And Jewish priests were kind of, if anybody maybe knows how to pronounce the name of the God of Israel, it might be these people. And so these guys want to get in on the act, and it presumably word spreads, right? Like, there's power in the name of Jesus. Articles of this guy's clothing are healing people. And so they add Jesus's name to their incantation, right? The power of Christ compels you. And I believe that there is power in the name of Jesus, healing power as well as saving power. But the name of Jesus is not something that you and I will ever be able to use mechanically. It's not a name you just insert into a sentence that guarantees, like, God has to do what you ask now. God is not a vending machine, and it doesn't work that way. And so these guys are in for a tremendously rude awakening as they try to use the name of Jesus in this way, and the demon kind of rolls his eyes at them and says, well, Jesus I know, and Paul I respect. Who on earth are you guys? And I guess we'll just have to leave it to our imaginations what kind of a tornado touches down in the confines of this small house that one man sends seven scampering out the door, bleeding and naked. I mean, I'm just saying, that is a butt-kicking of in any century. It doesn't matter. And word quickly spreads that the name of Jesus is not something to be taken lightly. It has a tremendous impact. There's a sobering reality that sinks in for people. It doesn't undermine the message. It enhances it. And again, if I can draw just a little bit of connective tissue to Acts chapter 5, there's a different but a similar story. So quick retelling, if you recall, there's a couple in the early church, Ananias and Sapphira, and they want to be known for their generosity. So they sell some property and they bring some of the money to donate to the church. They're generous people, there's no doubt, but they really want to look more generous than they are, and so they lie about how much money they got for the property. This is everything we got, and it's a horrible story, right? They drop dead in the church, both of them, and here's what we read in Acts chapter 5 as a result of this. Great fear seized the whole church and all who heard about these events. So in the context and in the midst of tremendous miracles and great things, exciting things, celebratory things that are happening, this is a sobering reminder that you don't get too casual still with Jesus. What's the result here in Acts 19? It reads almost verbatim. They were all seized with fear, and the name of the Lord Jesus was held in high honor. There's a sense of respect, and it leads to a spirit of repentance. So here's what seems to be happening. That many of the Ephesian people are coming to faith, but they're not necessarily walking away from the magic practices that they've been steeped in. This is still part of kind of who they are, and they haven't felt a need to let go of it or get rid of it. And this isn't unusual, by the way. People come to faith in any context and in any century out of a variety of settings and backgrounds that they don't immediately necessarily feel the need to walk away from. Sometimes Christian maturity, is a process, and we come to these moments where the Word of God starts to just kind of, it sinks in such a way that we get a small glimpse of the ugliness of the sin that we're still carrying around. And when we get this picture of the ugliness of our sin, oftentimes you find people much more willing to let go of things that otherwise, up until that point, were very, very precious to us. And this seems to be what's happening here. There is an Ephesian writing burning that's happening. There is no question what's the kind of material is in the scrolls and writings that are getting thrown into the fire here. And our author estimates the value, which is fun. He goes, well, I just 50,000 drachmas. Now, I don't imagine that means a whole lot to most of us. So let me just give you a modern equivalent. A drachma was the equivalent of a day's wage. Minimum wage in this province is a little over $11. For the sake of creating a nice round number, let's assume it's a little bit above minimum. At $12.50 an hour, times an eight-hour day, I get $100 a day. Really nice number to work with. I think this is a low-ball estimate, okay? Assuming these writings are just above kind of a minimum day's wage, the estimate is $5 million. That's an expensive, you know, wiener roast or whatever. But and the summary statement then is the word of the Lord spread widely and grew in power. James referenced this in kind of our opening welcome here. And grew in power is a very appropriate summary statement for a city and people that are slowly coming out from under the influence of dark spiritual powers. Which brings us to the last part of our chapter, and there's a great story here. Let's read it.
About that time, there arose a great disturbance about the way. A silversmith named Demetrius, who made silver shrines of Artemis, brought in a lot of business for the craftsmen there. He called them together, along with the workers in related trades, and said, "You know, my friends, that we receive a good income from this business. You see and hear how this fellow Paul has convinced and led astray large numbers of people here in Ephesus, and in practically the whole province of Asia. There, he says that gods made by human hands are no gods at all. There is a danger not only that our trade will lose its good name, but also that the temple of the great goddess Artemis will be discredited, and the goddess herself, who is worshipped throughout the province of Asia and the world, will be robbed of her divine majesty." When they heard this, they were furious and began shouting, "Great is Artemis of the Ephesians!" Soon the whole city was in an uproar. The people seized Gaius and Aristarchus, Paul's traveling companions from Macedonia, and all of them rushed into the theater together. Paul wanted to appear before the crowd, but the disciples would not let him. Even some of the officials of the province, friends of Paul, sent him a message begging him not to venture into the theater. The assembly was in confusion. Some were shouting one thing, some another. Most of the people didn't even know why they were there. The Jews in the crowd pushed Alexander to the front, and they shouted instructions to him. He motioned for silence in order to make a defense before the people. But when they realized that he was a Jew, they all shouted in unison for about 2 hours, "Great is Artemis of the Ephesians!" The city clerk quieted the crowd and said, "Fellow Ephesians, doesn't all the world know that the city of Ephesus is the guardian of the temple of the great Artemis and of her image, which fell from heaven? Therefore, since these facts are undeniable, you ought to calm down and not do anything rash. You have brought these men here, though they have neither robbed the temple nor blasphemed our goddess. If, then, Demetrius and his fellow craftsmen have a grievance against anybody, the courts are open and there are proconsuls. They can press charges. If there is anything further you want to bring up, it must be settled in the legal assembly. As it is, we are in danger of being charged with rioting because of what happened today. In that case, we would not be able to account for this commotion, since there is no reason for it." After he had said this, he dismissed the assembly.
Awesome. Thanks, Karis. Luke informs us that there is a disturbance in the force. Oh, wait, that's a wrong story. Close, though. Luke informs us that there is a disturbance in the way. A common way of referring to Christianity in the first century, right? We mentioned at the outset, a lot of the city's economy is driven by worship at the temple. And Paul's effectiveness in reaching people for Jesus is starting to be felt in the wallets of those who are making their living from the worship of this goddess. And so Demetrius is the individual that seems to be kind of the ringleader of this. It is suggested that he is likely the leader of a guild of silversmiths in the city of Ephesus. And he very artfully, by the way, manages to articulate his concerns with less than obvious selfish motives. You know, like, the honor of our city and the glory of our God is at stake. Come on, guys. Like, this is... we can't let this happen. It's very, very much a big deal. Apparently, he's a persuasive rabble-rouser. A mob soon starts to form. Two of Paul's companions, Gaius and Aristarchus, are hauled into the amphitheater. This 25,000-seat capacity spectacle has a mob in it, and some of Paul's companions are forced into being a part of this. We get a picture that Paul wants to actually, I think this is just Paul's nature, but he's like, "I'll talk to the crowd." But a few of his closer friends, and apparently we'll come back to this later, some city officials kind of hold him back. "No, don't go in there. It's a bad idea." And so you have this wonderful mob scene that takes place. Like, confusion is reigning. And this is the nature of getting caught up in a crowd-like spectacle. People don't even know why they're there. It's just you're part of this contagious energy, and you can chant whatever you want. This is just... It's the emotion and the fuel of the moment that's driving you. Now, nobody wants to become the focal point of a crowd's negative energy. And it seems to us that the Jewish people are a little concerned that that might happen here. And this is not surprising because in the first century, it was common to mistake Judaism and Christianity. It's the same thing, right? Because they come from the same root story. And so the Jews, like, hey, they find this guy named Alexander. It's like, talk to the crowd, talk to the crowd. If somebody really angry gets on the phone, we'll do the same thing here. Oh, James, there's a phone call for you. Somebody has to get up there and be the spokesperson. And who doesn't want to talk to the happiest man on the earth? So Alexander draws the short straw and he gets up there presumably to say, in essence, by the way, we don't agree with what this guy says either. He's not with us, just saying. And he doesn't get a chance. The crowd recognizes that he's Jewish, and it results in this two-hour shouting match. Great is Artemis of the Ephesians. I was thinking this past week that soccer fans are notorious for loud, boisterous singing throughout a match. You can get a stadium of 60,000 fans in World Cup singing for an hour. It's not ridiculous. We don't tend to get that as much. We are at the tail end of our hockey playoffs here. And for those that are Montreal Canadian fans, I just will say that is one group of hockey fans that's notorious for singing. Ole, ole. I don't know who wants to listen to that for 2 hours, much less sing it for 2 hours. But this is the ancient equivalent, if I can just say that. 2 hours, great as Artemis of the Ephesians. And you got to think that finally, just due in no small part to hoarse throats and just exhaustion that would set into the crowd, that just finally, like, the crowd is done. Like, it's just, why are we singing? Do you remember? No, but it was a good song. Okay. And this gives an opportunity for a city clerk to find, and this would have been a city clerk, we tend to think, like, low-level guy. Probably one of the most important people in the city, would have been the primary go-between between the city of Ephesus and the Roman Empire. Finally has a chance to get up, address the crowd, and he's brilliant. This guy is just as, I think our expression is, cool as a cucumber. But he gets up there and basically makes 4 points. He's like, we should just be clear here, guys. Everybody knows the reputation our city has for Artemis. Our loyalty to the goddess and her divine majesty and whatever is just, it's not in doubt. We don't need to pick it, you know, or demonstrate in order to somehow bolster this. Secondly, correct me if I'm wrong, but I don't think anybody's broken any laws, have they? Just checking? No? Okay. Thirdly, if there's a charge or a complaint, you know we have, like, legal recourse for this, right? There's channels that this can run through. And lastly, just so that we're aware, this kind of a riotous outburst, it runs the risk of drawing a little of negative attention from Rome. And none of us really want to be a part of that. Anybody? And at that point, you can picture half the crowd going, really? That's what we're here? That's why we're here? Oh, and it just kind of diffuses the whole situation. And it's wonderful. I love this story. What do we do with this? Don't preach in amphitheaters. I don't know. There's a lot of things. Let me give you a few things that strike me from this story in particular. And I'll begin by saying, if you build it, they might not come. If I can borrow a little bit of our cultural heritage that is Kevin Costner's movie, The Field of Dreams, and paraphrase it for my own purposes here. I am fascinated. Let me rephrase. I'm stereotyping here, but I think the primary form of Christian outreach in roughly the last century has been, if you can bring people to church, they will be saved. It's just kind of the mindset. Bring the people so they can hear the evangelist and good things will happen. Boom, problem solved. And God has blessed this. Don't get me wrong. God has blessed this in and throughout some of our 20th century history. Most of our world today is, I think we would say, unchurched. And unfamiliar even enough with the gospel story that the odds of them walking through the door of a church, not high. So don't hear me criticizing. If you have friends that you think might be curious about, you know, hearing more about Jesus and you feel comfortable bringing them to West Portal or asking them to check out our live stream feed, by all means do. One of the things that fascinates me about the example of Paul is that he doesn't generally use the church as his focal point for reaching out. So when he's in Corinth, he spends, you know, a few weeks or maybe a few months, it's an indefinite period of time, in the local synagogue, and then he spends a year and a half based out of a private home. And here in Ephesus, 3 months in the synagogue, okay, And then he spends 2 years in a public lecture hall. What would that be today? A theater? A coffee shop? Paul takes the good news of Jesus where people who need to hear the good news, where he's going to find them. And I love that, and I just think it's kind of a reminder for us too. One of the things that's fascinating this past year, and I've chatted with a number of you, there's a theme that's emerging from the year that has been COVID, and it's this. People are saying, I've had more conversations with neighbors and coworkers about big life questions than I've ever had before. There's something about a pandemic that has people just thinking about and processing differently than they have in the past. And I want to bless you to say that, by the way, the best place to have those conversations is going to be your sidewalk and your backyard and your school and your workplace and the local coffee shop. And just, I love what we get to do Sunday mornings. I love that we get to equip and encourage and inspire each other in the name of Jesus. But the good news of Jesus, the real good news sharing that happens is as we walk out of these doors and we carry that with us. That's part of the beauty of the story. And I think we see that from Paul. Oh, what else? In 1936, Dale Carnegie wrote what was to become a landmark book. I don't know if you remember this, How to Win Friends and Influence People. It's a self-help book just on relationships in general. I found myself thinking about that, just going, I wish that Paul had written an evangelism technique book. How to build relationships with people that don't know Jesus. I would love to read that. How do you talk to obstinate Jews? You know? How do you talk to, he'd have a brilliant number of chapters. I want to draw your attention to something that in this passage I've always read over. It's just something that I've never really dug into before. So, quick backstory here. Mob is forming. Paul's companions are pulled in front of this amphitheater or whatever. Angry people shouting. Paul goes, I think I'd like to just address this mob. And he's stopped from doing this. But do you remember how the story goes? So who pulls him down? So our author says, but the disciples would not let him. Okay, so some Jesus followers tell Paul, don't go, that's a bad idea. But the second sentence is fascinating. Even some of the officials of the province, friends of Paul, sent him a message begging him not to venture into the theater. So some believers reach out to Paul and say, please don't go. And apparently and implicitly, some non-Christian friends also say, don't go. Now, the Greek word is asiarch. It's fascinating. It is likely we are talking about here fairly high-ranking people. Think of them as delegates of the city of Ephesus to the provincial council of all of Asia. So significant high-ranking people who we believe, whose responsibilities, amongst other things, will have involved ensuring and overseeing worship of Rome and the emperor. Now, I don't know if you remember this. We talked about this, the worship of Rome and the emperor, when we were unpacking Revelation, that book, and just kind of setting the table. This is kind of a non-starter for Christians in the first century. There's a lot of things they could be open-handed about. This was one of them. This was a deal breaker for them. It says, obey our government? Not a problem. Honor the emperor? Not a problem. Worship? That's going to be a problem. I don't think I can do that. Now, which means these are people who Paul, for faith-based reasons, is 180 degrees opposed to, at least in practice. Does that make sense? He's not supportive of what these people are about. But these are friends of his. In fact, Paul is so warmly regarded by this group that they find a way to reach out to him and say, please don't go into the theater. Don't put yourself in harm's way. It's a bad idea. Now, I'm stereotyping again, but when it comes to outreach and in Christian culture, the Christian reputation that we have, now I'm speaking generally, but the Christian reputation that we have is that Christians do not make friends with people who are living lifestyles that don't honor Jesus. That's our reputation. That Christians will make friends if it gives us a chance to talk about Jesus, but if it doesn't look like people are actually interested in faith, then we go, well, you know, thanks. Would you like to be my friend? And we kind of hop from person to person. Now, it's a small reference in here, but I am fascinated that Paul appears to have established and formed deep friendships, compassionate friendships with people living very different lifestyle choices than what he, for his faith-based reasons, would support. And he has stayed friends with them, in spite of the fact that apparently they haven't come around to the idea of Jesus yet. And I wonder if there isn't a little bit of both a lesson and permission in this for us, that there is value, kingdom value, in loving people for the sake of loving people, for loving people as Jesus does, whether or not the heart ever changes. And that we have permission and freedom not to have to see people as projects. The relationship is, can we say a relationship is a project? I wouldn't be married if I hadn't, you know, at least a little bit treated a relationship like a project. You're going to invest in this strategically, right? But I love that. I think I would love to read the chapter that Paul might have written. How do I make friends with people who are living different lifestyle choices? Be fascinating to read. Last thought. Long obedience in the same direction. I'm borrowing here, of course, from Eugene Peterson. He coined this expression to refer to discipleship, the journey of being shaped to become like Jesus in an instant culture. He goes, we're just, this the slow process, the slow burn, we're just not good at. I just found myself wondering if there might not be a similar truth when it comes to outreach and evangelism, that there's benefits and a harvest, but it's not always an instant result. It's a long walk and a long investment in the same direction. I was already referencing this, but Paul spends some 2 years in Corinth. He spends some 3 years in Ephesus. That's 5 years of time. If we're right to infer that he actually has daily discussions in this lecture hall between 11 and 4 for the better part of 2 years, even if we give the boy Sabbaths off, that is over 3,000 hours of Jesus-based conversations in what would be the equivalent of like a local theater or coffee shop. Over 3,000 hours of Jesus-based conversations with people who might be curious and seeking. That's a lot of time. And maybe we're less surprised that our author says, so that all the Jews and Greeks in the province of Asia heard the word of the Lord. It radiated out because of this long, consistent, obedient friendship building and gospel storytelling. And again, I wonder if there maybe isn't something in there for us. I think it's Bill Gates that's usually attributed with the quote that says, you and I have a tendency to overestimate what we can accomplish in the short term, but we underestimate what's possible in the long term. I think Paul understood this. And he was willing to stick in locations and with people because he was in it for the long haul. Friends, be a gospel place, presence, in your workplaces, in your neighborhoods, in your schools, wherever you find yourself. Build and foster relationships with great freedom. You are the good news of Jesus, not just somebody with a message of good news. Learn people's stories. You'll have opportunity over time to share yours. Watch and see what God might delight to do in the midst of this. I'm convinced that it's God who causes seed to grow. But because God delights to partner with his people, and we see this all the way back to like the first chapters of Genesis, don't ask me why God insists that the best way to do this is in relationship with my people. I think he should just do it by himself. But he says, no, this is how we're going to do it. It's not the quick way, but this is how relationship develops. And I get to do this with you, and you come to know me as you engage this way. So friends, plant seeds. Plant seeds for the honor, for the glory, and for the kingdom of God. And let's see what kind of a harvest he might delight to do over time as we are found faithful. Amen? Let's pray. Jesus, thank you so much. Thank you so much for your great love. Thank you for the good news that sinful people have been made right, that relationship has been restored with a holy God, something we could not have done on our own. Our sin is forgiven. Scripture says you choose not to remember it. That's the extent of the forgiveness that you offer your children. But you don't just come to save souls. You invite us to be part of that story in the world. That good news influence, the contrast of community. If you want to see what it looks like to live in God's world, God's way, watch the people of God. Watch the church as they come together. They'll get it wrong. They're imperfect. But watch them. You're going to get a taste of and glimpse of the goodness of my kingdom. And until it comes in its fullness, this is where you're going to find me most fully expressed and present. And so Jesus, give us the grace to walk well, to be that kind of a faith community. Not just individuals with good news, but a good news community. Give us eyes to see the needs of those around us, to see opportunities here even in our surrounding neighborhoods where we could be good news. Gift us with a Holy Spirit-inspired courage, because we're fearful of this kind of thing. I don't know if I might say the wrong thing. Well, you're probably bigger than that. But give us a freedom to release our faithful efforts into your care, where you will multiply them and you will extend them for your honor and for your glory and for your continued work in this world. And so we say that we love you, and we ask that you would gift us with the ability to continue to follow you and be conformed to you more faithfully and more fully, even in the week ahead. And we want to pray your kingdom would come. And so I invite you to do that with me as we close. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen.